So basically now we are going to discuss the principle of seismic isolation, okay? And first I would be introducing you, like, you know, the overall idea, and then discussing about some type of seismic isolator application, mechanical behavior and modeling. But as part of this course, presentation, I would mostly be focusing on the basic idea behind the seismic isolation and giving you some of the structures that have been famously isolated using different type of isolators. Okay. Now, before I get into the idea of seismic isolation, first let us get into idea of seismic force or earthquake force, and then see how do we actually incorporate the idea of seismic isolation into it. Now, as a very simple formula, you know, I mean, and like, you know, this is oversimplification, but overall we know that the total force on any structure can approximately be written as mass of the structure times acceleration. Okay. And if you write mass of that structure as W by G, okay, and combine G with A, I can further write it as basically this here. Okay. Now, this W is what is called the seismic weight. Okay, and you would have come across this term if you would have doing seismic design and everything. This is the seismic weight. Now, you might come across this term many times. Okay, but let me just discuss what is the idea behind the seismic weight. Like, you know what is the dead weight of a structure. Okay, and you might estimate what are the live load acting on the structure. Seismic weight is typically defined as the weight that might be present during an event or an earthquake event for which the structure has been designed. Okay, so it would definitely include the dead weight of the structure plus certain portion of live load, because you typically consider live load for the extreme scenario in which you consider the structure to be fully loaded. Okay, and then you determine or estimate the live load. But during the normal operation, it is unlikely that your structure would be under the capacity of the full live load. So we typically take 25% or 50% of the live load. So dead weight plus, let us say, 50% of the live weight, live load, is basically considered or included in the seismic weight of the structure. And this A by G, which is the acceleration of the structure, not the ground motion as such. Okay, this is the acceleration of the structure. The A by G is basically called seismic coefficient. Now, most of the seismic analysis procedure, like linear static procedure or response spectrum procedure, okay, as per Indian codes, the seismic codes and the outside code, they give you procedure how to calculate this seismic coefficient here. Okay, and there you have, like, you know, remember this factor, you might see it as CR, okay, or other places this factor is written with some other notation, but basically this is the seismic coefficient through which, if you multiply with the seismic weight, you get the lateral load that is being applied on the structure. Okay, now this is basically the earthquake force or the lateral earthquake force. Now this A, which is the acceleration of the structure, I can also say this is the SA or the spectral acceleration, let us say. Okay, now we know that a spectral acceleration of any structure is a function of time period of that structure, and time period in turn is a function of mass of the structure and the stiffness of the structure. And of course, what I'm writing here is valid for single degree of freedom system, but we can extend this same concept for multi-degree of freedom system as well. Okay. Now, if you look at the design spectra, and this is the typical shape of a design spectra, okay, due to an earthquake or at a particular location of a building or a structure, you initially have an increasing spectral acceleration with time period, then there is a constant phase, and then there is this decrease. Now, most of the structure, okay, If it's a rigid structure, it would have typical time period of around 2 seconds. Okay. If it's a like, you know, moment frame building, like, you know, tall building, then you can go, it can go up to 1 second or even 1.2 second and further up. But typically we say that a typical structure is in range of 0.25 second to 1 second, which on the response spectra falls in this zone. Okay. Now, let us say I have a technology, okay, or I want to reduce the force transferred to the system. So what should be the, what should we do? I mean, I know that the seismic weight of the structure is fixed, so that cannot be changed, right? Similarly, the mass of the structure is fixed, so that cannot be changed. The only thing that I can tinker with or I can change is seismic coefficient. Yeah, time period, right? And how would I change the time period? Mass or stiffness?
By mass. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay, but mass, remember, typically mass of a structure in a design is fixed, right? It is determined by weight of the infill, beam and column weight, okay, live weight, and those things does not depend on the structure. Basically, I mean, it depends somewhat on the structural properties, the geometric properties, but overall, there's not much you can do about the mass. But what you can do is about the stiffness. Okay. And let me just delete that here. I know that time period is nothing but 2 pi under root m by k. And I know that if I want to reduce the force, seismic force, I would need to reduce the seismic coefficient or spectral acceleration. How do I reduce that? Let us say initially my structure was here. If I want to reduce that, then I have to go in this range, right? Not this, because there is not decrease in that part. So I need to come along on this part of the response spectra. Now, if I do that, okay, that means I need to decrease the time period. Okay. And I know time period is 2 pi mass by k, or the stiffness. To decrease the Tn, okay, what can I, oh sorry, in this case, not decrease, I'm sorry. Increase the time period to decrease the force. Okay, so to increase the time period, what can I do? If mass is increased, then time period is what?
Increased.
If stiffness is decreased, then?
Time period. It is.
So basically our goal is to decrease the stiffness. Okay, so we have found out one conclusion. That if I want to reduce seismic force on a structure, we should have a system or the structural system which has low stiffness. Okay. All right. So the design objective for a seismic design is basically reduction in seismic forces. Okay. So increase Tn through reduction in stiffness. Okay. Now increase the time now. Remember, if this is your acceleration response spectra, okay, remember there is also displacement response spectra, right? So for a typical acceleration response spectra like this, a deformation response spectra I have drawn on the right hand side. Okay, so what happens as you decrease or as you increase the time period and decrease the forces, what happens to the spectral displacement? Let us say initially I was here, T1. I increase the time period so that my forces decreased. Okay. So let us say initially I was here and then T2 I was here. So my force or the acceleration is decreasing. But what is happening to the displacement here? My displacement, and this should be actually SD here. It is incorrectly written as SA. Okay. So this is SD, which is the displacement. Okay, displacement is actually increasing, and that might be a matter of concern, especially if you consider closely spaced building in a dense urban environment. Okay, so we need to control displacement as well. Now we know by increasing the time periods, we can decrease the force, but increasing the time period is creating a problem for me because it is going to increase the displacement. So I need to address that issue. So let us see how do we do that. So As I discussed, if I increase the time period, it would lead to decrease in the acceleration and subsequently decrease in the forces. So initially, if let us say this was acceleration SA1, it becomes SA2, and SA2 is much smaller than SA1. However, I was initially, okay, so initially I was here, my displacement, and this was SD1. As I increase the time period to T1 to T2, remember this is the spectra I have, I increased the displacement from SD1 to SD2. So in order to control the displacement, what do we need to do? We need to increase the damping in the system. Now, what does damping do? It basically decreases the displacement, and my response spectra, or the displacement response spectra that I was having it here, by increasing the damping, I can reduce it to here. Now, if I do that, then I'm able to bring my displacement down either below the initial level or maybe control the displacement to an extent that it is not detrimental to my structure anymore. Okay. So, period lengthening lead to force reduction. Okay. And if we provide damping, which is basically energy dissipation, it leads to displacement reduction. And through these two, okay, we basically control the response of the structure. And that's why at many places you will also see that seismic isolation is studied as a part of seismic response control or seismic control of structures. Okay, there are other technologies also involved in seismic control, like you can have viscous damper or other type of tuned mass damper, or you can have other technologies. But basically, seismic response control means applying technologies so that I can control the response of the structure to a desired value. Okay. Any question up to this point?
Sir, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Sir, can we say that if we, in order to increase the time period, if we go increase the mass, that will increase the seismic weight, and then finally the force may increase?
Definitely, it will do that. So if you increase the mass, it will increase the time period. Okay. But consider a typical example. Let us say we have a concrete building. Okay. And if you want to design it, can you do much about the mass of the building that you are designing? Maybe, sir, you can change it by 10%, 20%, but can you do much, I mean, as a designer, can you do anything about the mass?
We cannot do much, but like I wanted to counter that with that, that if we increase the time period, it is going to have a like proportionally to it is under root m.
Yes, yes, it would. So that's why what happens.
And the force
heavy structure, heavy structure are more suitable for seismic isolation rather than light structure. So basically, you would not apply seismic isolation to a wood structure. There is, I have not come across any application like that. Although many of the houses outside are made up of wood structure, because wood structure itself is very light and the stiffness is very low. Okay, and they adequately perform during the earthquake as well. But even steel structure, when we apply, we try to stiffen the superstructure. Okay, because steel structure is also lighter. But for concrete structure, seismic isolation is very good. If you have heavy, let us say, masonry structure, for that also it can be applied, and any type of structure. So for heavy structure, of course, your seismic isolation is more effective because you already have mass. Okay, that helps in increasing the time period of the isolated structure. Okay. Any other question?
Yes, sir. So, with respect to previous question, Sarjeet sir has asked. So, basically, whenever we design a structure, first of all, we as a designer, we design a structure like it should be economical, first of all, and like these are the factors that we keep in mind. And if we forget those factors and we decide, we think that let's increase the mass. So would it be a better way to reach the solution?
See, those factors come from the uncertainty in the loading or design. Okay, so let us say you estimate some loads, okay, and you estimate, let us say, live load, and you know that there are certain uncertainty associated with that. Okay, so those factors would still need to be there, because the uncertainty associated with that load is taken into consideration with the load factors. Okay, and uncertainty associated with the strength of material is taken with the strength factors. Okay, that cannot be addressed through seismic isolation. It's an entirely different technology that is more of a statistical and risk perspective. And what here is basically in terms of the technical aspect of it. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Now, you might think that seismic isolation is a very new technology. Okay. And, you might have seen the recent application. But the overall idea behind seismic isolation technology is actually not very new. Support my argument, what I'm showing you right here is a very old structure. Okay, it is basically a tomb built on stone blocks. Okay, and this is basically in Persia. And as you know, that region is actually very prone to earthquake. And see, this is like 530 BC. Okay, this is the tomb of King Cyrus the Great. Now, this is basically very big stones, okay, being kept over each other, and the tomb is kept on the top of the structure. This has survived, okay, even it is there right now. So you can imagine 2000 and then maybe 2500 years this structure has survived. And how? Now, the idea remains simple. During an earthquake, these stones are actually not filled with mortar, okay, and these can slide over each other. So when the earthquake comes, it does not allow the transmission of the force from the ground to the tomb, and the overall force that is transmitted to the structure, okay, is significantly smaller. Because when they slide over each other, you can assume or you can imagine that it would have very small lateral stiffness. Okay. And this was built very long time ago. Similarly, this is a very famous structure you might have seen in photos, movies, or some other place. This is a Parthenon in Athens. Okay. It has survived earthquakes for 2100 years. Okay. And when it was finally damaged, it wasn't damaged due to an earthquake. It was damaged due to an explosion. Okay. Now, as you know, Greece is a very seismically active region. There are a lot of earthquakes, and over the 2100 years, it has still survived. Now, the design of these structures are very simple. Basically, what you have modular blocks. So each of the column, if you see, this contains modular blocks which are kept over each other, and then there is a central hole through which you can have, let us say, post tensioning kind of mechanism, or you can have a single rod to keep it in place. But effectively what it does, it reduces the lateral stiffness significantly. So you can see, I mean, in all these structures, what the engineers, as you can see at that time, what they simply did is basically they change the lateral stiffness of the system so that overall stiffness reduced significantly. Okay. Now the stiffness is reduced, the overall force transferred to the structure is also reduced. And that's why they have survived for so long. Okay. Any question up to this point? Okay. Now, some of you might know or you might not know. Yeah.
Even though they it allowed a sliding, was there not instability created due to subsequent earthquakes?
there might be instability if the superstructure mass is very large. Now, as you can see, we have only roof here. So the overall load coming on each of these columns are not by much. And even when they slide, I mean, the overall deformation by each of the columns are not that much that it would lead to a lot of instability. If it would have like, you know, very heavy structure or very heavy superstructure on top of these columns, the overall P delta effect would have been significant, and that would have led to instability problem.
Yes. Yes.
Good point. Thank you. Now, you might ask, when was the first patent related to seismic isolation technology? We do not exactly know, because, you know, I mean, there are different type of technologies which look like seismic isolation technology, and people file the patent for that. One of the first known instances is basically this US patent that was issued to basically Jules Stolia of San Francisco, and it was issued in February 1870. And the figure is from that patent application. If you look at it, he has simply shown a schematic of a house, and this house is kept on a foundation. And if you look at the magnified view here, okay, this is nothing but rollers. Okay, so you have like, you know, cylindrical rollers, and then you have overall base mat, you can say, and your foundation. And when the earthquake comes, again, it can roll over each other. So it provides the restoring force now as well as sliding. Okay. And this was one of the first known instances of, patent issued in this area. Okay. So let us look at seismic demand. Okay. On a regular structure and base isolated structure. Okay. So what I am showing you here is basically a traditional conventional fixed base building. Now, what you have seen till now, we can achieve seismic isolation if you provide a horizontally flexible layer. And I will show you different type of seismic isolator, but let us just for right now assume that this is an isolation layer. So the left hand side, you have a structure that is fixed to the ground. On the right hand side, you have the same structure, but now it is isolated through an isolation layer. Okay. Now, what typically happens during an earthquake? Okay. The overall seismic demand is accommodated by the superstructure, isn't it? So, deformation, acceleration, and the velocity demand is basically accommodated by the superstructure. Because of deformation demand, it leads to deformation in these beams and columns, and that leads to basically cracks development, plastic hinge formation, and if the demand is too large, may. So the seismic design technology, what it tries to achieve is to provide enough ductility in the system so that it can accommodate such seismic demand in the superstructure. So it can go in the nonlinear range, but it can still accommodate, okay, this much of drift demand without collapse. And basically the performance goal is typically collapse prevention. Okay. Now compare that, and that I only talked about in terms of drift or displacement, let us say. Now, if you look at it, while you might protect against drift demand, what will happen to the, you know, objects and machinery and people inside this building? If you look at this, and you might think like, you know, those things might not be expensive, but just think of a hospital building or a hospital structure. In a hospital, the structure cost, you know, it is typically nothing. Most of the cost is actually machinery. A typical MRI machine might cost north of, let us say, 10 crores, 15 crores, like that. And there are several such machines, scanning machines. So those are of much more value that needs to be protected. Okay. Now, you might protect by, let us say, making the structure very strong. But if you make the structure very strong, it would have, again, large stiffness and acceleration. So acceleration is not reduced, because if your stiffness is more, then the acceleration would be more. So you still have the acceleration demand, and that would lead to acceleration in the internal components. So with the traditional design philosophy, seismic design philosophy, you may be able to protect your structure against the drift demand up to a certain extent, but the acceleration demand or the velocity demand might not be accommodated that efficiently as we would compare with a base isolated structure. Now, what happens in a base isolated structure? You have this superstructure, right? And this isolator layer. Now, because this is very flexible layer, all of the drift demand is actually accommodated at this isolation level here. So right here. Now, isolators have properties that it would have sufficient restoring forces that it can bring back the structure to its original position. It would have sufficient buckling capacity. Okay, it would not have any permanent or very minimal permanent damage. So that those things I can do by designing the isolator like that. But the superstructure, there is no drift or very small drift compared to the fixed base. So there is very less damage to the frames of the superstructure. At the same time, because my stiffness here is very small for this isolation layer, the acceleration is very small. So that's why internal, and so is the velocity. Okay. So the internal components are also actually protected. Okay. In a base isolated structure. So you can see the benefit of applying isolation here. Okay. Any question up to this point? Okay. So now you have seen, okay, some of the structures and examples. What should be the requirement of a seismic isolator? Okay. Now you know that seismic isolator must be horizontally flexible to increase the time period, because only with the increase of time period I would achieve reduction in the seismic forces and reduction in acceleration. Okay, so I need to have for this isolator. So through this slide, what I'm trying to find out, what should be the requirement of a seismic isolator, and then we will see different type of isolators that satisfy those requirements. Okay, so to achieve this horizontal flexibility, we can use horizontally flexible material or we can use sliding surface. Okay, when I see one surface is sliding over each other, what I basically means, in horizontal direction, it has very small stiffness or almost negligible stiffness. Okay. Now, it need to be horizontally flexible, but at the same time, it need to be actually stiff or vertically stiff, because see, your whole structure is still there, right? So even when it is moving flexibly in horizontal direction, at every point it would still need to sustain the vertical load, isn't it? So it need to be actually stiff. Now, how do we increase the axial stiffness? We will look at later, but basically the axial, we know that, let us say, if you have a simple column and if you have line axial load, okay, I know that a shorter column would have higher capacity or higher buckling capacity, isn't it? Or if I provide lateral restraint, it would have higher capacity. Okay, so basically I would need something that is either laterally restrained, okay, in terms of axial stiffness, or it has large compressive modulus. Okay, if I would have those property, then I can accommodate large vertical loads or the total load of structure. Okay. Now, it should also accommodate large displacement, because as I said in the previous slide, when you did not have an isolator, okay, the whole drift demand this much was being accommodated by the superstructure. Now imagine displacement demand of the similar order now need to be accommodated by the isolators. Okay. So it should be able to carry large displacement. So it should have elastic property, or even if it does not have elastic property, it should have property which should be recoverable. Okay. So some of the materials have that kind of property, like recrystallization, especially like lead in lead rubber bearing. Okay. Now we also want damping, because we don't want too much of displacement. Otherwise, it would lead to pounding effect to the next building or instability. So to control the displacement and other response quantity, we basically want some dissipation of energy, or I can say damping. Now, there are different ways in which we can achieve damping. One is friction. So if you have a sliding surface friction, like, you know, sliding over each other, it leads to generation of heat because of friction and ultimately leading to loss of energy. Okay, and that is what is damping is. You might also dissipate energy through hysteresis. So if you have a material, let us say elastic plastic material or bilinear material, which dissipates energy, that would also allow dissipation of energy. Okay, then at the end, what you don't want, that after an earthquake your structure is remaining in the displaced position. Okay, because then residual deformation would lead to serviceability issues. So you want your structure or the isolation layer to have adequate restoring force so that it can bring back the structure to its original position. Okay, so you want either elastic restoring force, let us say with the rubber, or you want maybe through a curvature, okay, so that structure slides back to its original position. But there should be some adequate restoring force in the base isolated structure. Okay, so these are the basic requirements from the seismic isolator. Okay, any isolator that satisfy these requirements may be investigated further for application or to be utilized as a seismic isolator. Okay, any question up to this point? Okay, so yeah, anybody?
So by hysteresis, like, can you give me some example, like how this hysteresis will help me?
So basically let us say or you simple take example of an elastoplastic material. Now what happens in the elastoplastic material? It goes like this, okay, under cyclic loading, and this is considered as energy dissipation. Okay, and this energy dissipation is basically, it might be lost in the generation of heat or something else, but due to this energy dissipation, it leads to effective damping in the system. So if you, let us say, if you input certain amount, let us say it's a seismic energy, right? And if you input the, let us say 100 joules amount of seismic energy into a system, and some of the energy is dissipated through the damper, and the overall energy remaining is basically 50%, then only this 50% is what would be responsible for the excitation of the system, isn't it? So we want basically some energy dissipation capacity or capability, and it is very helpful because it leads to reduction in the response.
Okay. Yeah, so if I'm talking about friction, so I can imagine that how friction by rubbing two materials or same material at one surface, it will dissipate. So in hysteresis, I'm not getting okay.
So basically, you are saying that how does it dissipate energy, right?
Exactly.
Remember, even if you consider any material at a molecular level, each material of made up of small, like for example, rubber. Okay. Now, when you deform this material, which is made up of such small particles, these materials actually slide over each other at a molecular level, right?
Got it.
And because of that one sliding, so this one friction at, let us say,
molecular level,
it leads to hysteresis at the global level or macro level. So we will call this micro, and the overall thing we will call macro. Okay, so macro versus micro. Okay, and that ultimately leads to dissipation of energy, and that is true for any dissipating energy material as well. Okay.
Sir,
okay.
Can we say that these are the seismic isolator requirements only for those structure which is like divided into superstructure and substructure? If we like other structures like substructures, if we call of tunneling or something, then there some of the requirements is not required, it seems.
Can you give us some examples so that I have an idea what kind of example, like structures you are thinking about?
like tunnels are separated through ground from the grounds using like isolated from the grounds using geofoams.
Mm-hmm.
And geofoams are such that it is it doesn't fit into first two. That is like it will accommodate large deformation, allow energy dissipation. That is mainly like energy dissipation for that we are going to use that.
So you can say that that maybe utilizes a seismic response control material. Okay. But isolator basically means to isolate something from the surrounding. Okay. So it's all a matter of definition. You know, I mean, if you want to define it like that, that is fine. But when we talk about seismic isolator, traditionally we say that it is any technology that can be utilized to isolate either superstructure or like, you know, any type of building or like, you know, any type of other structure from the detrimental effect. So isolate from the ground motion, we typically say. Or if it's a equipment isolation, then basically isolate from the floor vibration. But in the end, isolation basically means that how you can isolate it. And when we say seismic isolation, then we say that isolated from the ground motion. Okay, so you know there are different type of seismic response control measures. Like you can have damper, you can have tune mass damper, you can have viscous damper, and in those fit in the broad, those technologies fit in the broader criteria, basically broader area of seismic response control, but not seismic isolation. Okay.
So, sir, tunnels, like the tunnel liners are isolated from the ground, ground that is soil, using geofoam. So that we cannot call that as a seismic isolator.
I don't think we can call that seismic isolator. That would just simply be called as like, you know, geofoams or like, you know, seismic, basically seismic reduction, yeah, seismic controlled geofoams or something like that. That, like, you know, of course, control the seismic response, but may not be categorized as seismic isolator.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
So now, I have a question.
Yes.
In seismic isolating structures, do we have foundations? Do we have?
We have. I'll show you how we connect isolator to the foundation and everything. Okay. So broadly, satisfying the requirements that I have just discussed, two of the popular type of isolator, and these are not only the two type of isolators that are available right now. There are many other isolators as well, but these are very popular because of their reliability and basically application to wide range of structure. The left hand side, what you see here is a cut view. So this is not an overall, isolator. What they have done, they have cut it. So you are seeing basically the internal section of a lead rubber bearing. Now, what you see here is a multiple layer of rubber, okay, constrained by steel shims in between. Okay. And then there are bearing plate, this is the internal bearing plate. And then there is a bolted external bearing plate. Now, this bolted external bearing plate is how this is connected to the substructure and superstructure. Okay, these rubber layers are the one that provided horizontal flexibility. The steel shim, the role of steel shims here is basically provide lateral restraint to the rubber, and I'll show you why do we need that. The lead is a very good energy dissipation material, plus it recrystallizes when you bring it back to its original position and temperature. So its properties are actually recoverable. So it dissipates energy, but after some time when you leave it, it will acquire its original property back. So it is not exactly elastic, but if you bring it back to original position, at molecular level, it recrystallizes and again would give you similar kind of energy dissipation capacity like the one you had before. Okay, so this is the one of the example of elastomeric bearing. On the right hand side, okay, what you have actually is basically a sliding bearing. Okay, and remember, this is not again the whole sliding bearing. What you see here is the internal surface on which this block here slides, and the top plate is kept on the in the corner, as you can see. Okay, so this kept on the top of that, and again this is bolted, so it is connected from the top and bottom using these bolts, and when the structure comes, it basically slides over this. Now this sliding surface provides you very low horizontal stiffness. Okay, the curvature provides you restoring force. Okay, because it is like a pendulum. If you take a pendulum, the restoring force is mg sin theta. Okay, now these two type of system, either rubber based or sliding based elastomeric systems, are typically used in today's seismic isolation applications. Okay, and we will look into these type of systems further. So what I want to show you here is basically example of a building. Okay, it's a full scale building. I don't know whether you know this or not. This is a shakeable facilities in University of California, San Diego. Okay. I think somebody might have joined or something. Yeah, Arup Guha. Am I pronouncing that right? Can you hear us? Can you please unmute yourself? Yeah, I think he's gone. Okay. Let us get back to our lecture. So this is one of the biggest shake table facility in the world. And what you see here is basically a structure that is built on top of that. On the base, there is a basically a platform, a shake table platform. So the ground motion is being applied through this shake table platform. And this structure is isolated. Now on the right hand side, okay, you see the magnified view of the isolator below the base mat. Okay, so here, keep an eye here. Okay, I will start it, the video. And then we'll see. Okay, so Rimpi, did you see how the isolator was actually connected to the superstructure and how was it moving?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so yeah, go ahead.
Because of ground movements, it may happen that your foundation get damaged. So in that situation, what to do?
Foundation get damaged because of ground deformation or because of the seismic forces?
It can be anything. I mean,
if you look at it, where does the forces, like, you know, come on the foundation? From the superstructure, right? If you have a heavy superstructure, and if the load coming, lateral load on the superstructure is very large, foundation has to transfer that load to the ground, correct?
Yes.
Now, if the overall force on the superstructure is small, then the overall load on the foundation would also be small. Yes. I'm talking about the lateral load, okay, not the vertical load. Vertical load would still be almost comparable, okay? And of course, we are not talking about things like liquefaction of the soil or anything, because that would be there anyway, whether you have seismic isolation or not. So that you do during the geotechnical things, investigation and report, okay? So overall, seismic isolators can be broadly characterized, and what are, like, you know, typically used in nowadays, basically these types. Elastomeric bearings, and in the elastomeric, you can have low damping rubber bearing or lead rubber bearing. And as we will look at later, low damping and lead rubber bearings are basically almost same, except in lead rubber bearing, you have a lead to allow higher damping or energy dissipation capacity that comes because of the lead. Okay. Similarly, you can have sliding bearings. Now, in sliding bearings, you can have flat slider bearing. You can have friction pendulum bearings. Okay. In friction pendulum, you can have single, double, or triple. And the way we categorize these bearings are basically the number of sliding surfaces. Based on that, we say either these are single sliding surface, then single pendulum bearings, and then double friction pendulum bearing or triple. There is also, like, another type of bearing, which is, like, you know, tension and compression friction isolator, but those are not very common. Okay. Now, throughout the course, I will show you some, like, you know, some sliding bearings as well, or friction pendulum bearings as well. But our focus would be on elastomeric bearings.
Manish sir, can I speak?
Yes, please.
I have heard of rocker bearings also.
Yes, so, there are rocker bearings also, correct? Rocker bearings look something like this. You have a surface like this.
Yes.
And on this one, you can have, let us say, column, and here, basically a slotted this thing. So because of this rocker thing, basically it leads to reduction in the horizontal stiffness. Yeah, please go ahead.
So is it in use or obsolete nowadays? Elastomeric bearings are preferred, neoprene pad bearings and all, for especially bridges.
There are some applications, but now imagine if you, as a building designer, would have to use, would you go for this type of bearing? Then why not go for directly sliding bearings? Okay, this would be much more stable. It would provide you enough capacity as well. Okay. And the force transferred would also be smaller.
Okay, so according to performance, we are now moving on.
Yeah. Now, we are mostly, like, you know, if we size for the perspective of seismic isolation, we are mostly utilizing either rubber elastomeric bearings or friction pendulum or sliding bearings. Okay.
Okay. Because when we are studying that, we refer that Jagdish Jairam book, In Design of Bridges.
Mm-hmm.
And there, this is mentioned. A rocker bearing is also mentioned. So we are not coming across.
So bridge bearings, bridge rocker bearings are a little bit different. Huh. Okay. Those are still used. Those are not seismic isolation bearings. Okay. So in general term, bearings are used, like, you know, at many places. Like, bearings are used, ball bearings, you know. It is also used in mechanical engineering. The rocker bearings that are used for bridges, they are still used. Okay. Those are not for seismic. Isolation application. Like, even the neoprene pads that are used in bridges, they are not for seismic isolation. They are only for providing or accommodating expansion joint or accommodating traffic load deformation and those things. Okay.
Okay.
For seismic isolation, Yeah, for seismic isolation, it needs to accommodate large deformation capacity.
Yeah, this was not known to us. Thank you, sir.
Yeah,
okay, continue, please.
Any other question?
Can I, I joined late. Can I actually make a comment?
Yes,
actually,
please.
I used to be in bridge design. So rocker bearings, actually, presently, they are not being used because the picture you draw has drawn, actually, that is a concave type thing. So what
What I drawn is basically what has been used for seismic applications.
Right. Actually, in this... bridges also, actually there is a horizontal plate on which there is a concave kind of thing which actually tries to rock. Mm-hmm. So what happens is that, first of all, there is corrosion of steel. That is one problem. And the second is that there is accumulation of sand, dust, actually particles. So they get deposited and ultimately the rocking stops. So that is why actually we don't try to apply this thing anymore.
Yes. That is now they are using neoprene and PORTCOM, PTFE bearing, PORTCOM, those type of bearings are used being used in bridges. So the point you actually mentioned is a very important point, because even for seismic isolation application, if you look at it, okay, these steel surfaces, that accumulation of dust is a big issue. So here what they do, they use a cover. So the overall thing is actually, there is a cover, whole thing is actually covered inside a closed this thing. And this surface here is polished, and there is a layer that is applied on this, basically a polymer layer that is applied on this surface. Because change in the value of friction is a major issue with the sliding bearing. Because let us say you are designing your superstructure for certain load transfer, and if your coefficient of friction increases, then the overall load that is being transferred to your structure would also increase. And then that becomes a problem. So to maintain that, they take some countermeasures in sliding type bearings by making it very polished and then covering it completely, so there is no sand or dust accumulation. And it is of stainless steel. So those type of countermeasures they did. But thank you for your input. That is, you are also mentioning some other point, right? Please go ahead.
No, I was actually regarding the neoprene part, there is a longevity issue of neoprenes. Actually, when it gets compressed from top, the edges actually bulge.
Yes.
Side, they bulge. So actually what is done in bridges, there are horizontal steel plates intermittent so that the bulging is actually arrested. Means I can't show here, but top figure.
If you have a single rubber block of this much, or if you have same thickness, and if you have steel plates in between, this would have less bulging than this one. Okay, and this is what you can see here. This is the internal construction of an isolation bearing, in which you have intermittent steel plates, which are called steel shims. And these are used to prevent that bulging, or effectively you can say to increase the vertical load capacity. So this is done basically in isolation as well. And coming to the issue of neoprene longevity, basically what happens, neoprene is basically a synthetic rubber. Now, after 10-15 years, you have to keep basically inspecting these neoprene bearings that they are still providing adequate performance. Otherwise, you need to replace this. In isolation, we are now moving towards natural rubber bearings. What has been seen with natural rubber bearing, that these type of bearings actually would have less strength degradation or less environmental issue or degradation issue over the time. So that's why in US they have almost shifted to natural rubber bearing. In Europe they are still using little bit, but overall natural rubber bearing, if you replace neoprene with a natural, it performs much better for seismic isolation, of course. Any other comments or questions?
No, sir. Right now, there's no questions.
Thank you for your input. Sir. I'm very happy that you guys are participating more and more. And of course, you all have diverse knowledge in different areas. So I would very like it very much that at every point, if you have some input to provide, please feel free to go ahead and let other contestants also share your experience and knowledge in that particular area. Yeah, madam, you were saying something?
Yes, sir. So in friction single pendulum bearings, so basically in that structures in elements also we need to check the durability also, like as you said, these are packed with the cover, these are covered with material, so
yes, rubber, basically they have this, like, you know, rubber cover on the sides to protect any ingress of materials from outside.
But still we need to check the main durability of these.
So
or
typically the way these quality controls are applied on these, and these are very expensive bearings, just to tell you. Okay. These friction bearings that I am showing you right now, and like, you know, they have been produced all around the world by different companies like Dynamic Isolation System, Mageba. There are different type of companies. THK is there. These do not have so much of longevity issue, sliding bearings, once they utilize it. But of course, like any critical structure, the provisions are there in the codes that you inspect it after. There should be a periodic inspection of any bearing, in fact, okay, to ensure that there is, let us say, no tearing or wearing, or there is, like, you know, sufficient amount of that there is no ingress of foreign materials into that. So, like, you know, those kind of countermeasures are actually taken care of.
And this kind of issue are not actually in these elastomeric bearings, right?
No, that would be there in elastomeric bearings as well. Both elastomeric bearings have other kind of issues. Like, you have ingress issues in the sliding bearings, or, like, you know, change in the coefficient of friction. The problem with rubber is that over the time, the property of the rubber actually changes. It changes because of environmental condition, like sunlight, or, like, you know, it might change because of rubber, which is basically a material that keeps on getting cured over, like, you know, long amount of time. So the shear modulus might change. So those are issues are there with both of these, but typically those are being taken care of in the design itself by estimating that, let us say, over 15-20 years, the shear modulus is going to increase by 10%. So we do bounding analysis saying that even after changing the property, my structure should still be able to sustain those loads and deformation demand from the earthquake.
Okay, sir.
So one kind request to all of you, after you ask questions, please switch on your mic, because this is being recorded. So whatever you say or the background noise that is coming, it actually gets recorded. So mute your mic after you're done with the question. And then whenever you have to ask the question, just unmute yourself and ask the question. So let us now discuss elastomeric bearings. Now, as I said, in terms of elastomeric bearings, we would be discussing low damping rubber bearings and lead rubber bearings. And lead rubber bearing is nothing but low damping rubber bearing with a lead core. And the role of the lead core here is basically to provide energy dissipation capacity. Okay. And then there are also other type of bearings which are high damping rubber bearings. Construction wise, high damping rubber bearings is same as low damping rubber bearing. These do not have lead core. The source of energy dissipation actually comes from the rubber itself. Okay. So by changing the composition of the rubber, you can achieve damping properties. Okay. In high damping rubber bearing, this used to be popular at the beginning, but now people are moving more towards lead rubber bearing and low damping rubber bearings, because what happens, we use basically natural rubber. And natural rubber do not have inherent damping capacity as much as neoprene bearing. Because remember, natural rubber bearings, basically it is naturally cured rubber from the trees. So I don't know whether you know the manufacturing process of rubber. Rubber is actually, natural rubber is actually obtained from the trees. If you cut like, you know, the outer layer of tree, and basically from that, whatever you get from there, and you can go have watch some videos. Those rubber are actually obtained from those trees. Neoprene rubber, which is also synthetic rubber, can be produced in the lab by changing the composition of the materials and chemicals. Okay, and by adding different type of additives, you can increase the damping or decrease the damping. The problem with that is that over time, as we talked about the longevity issue, high damping rubber bearing and neoprene rubber bearing have more longevity issue, and they over the time degrades more compared to natural rubber, which does not have any kind of additives. Because with the carbon filler, sulfur or other type of materials that are used to basically obtain neoprene rubber, they keep on reacting over the time, okay, over the years. Okay, so these dormant reactions are like, you know, keep on going over the time, and that's why it's changing its property. Now, as a designer, if you're designing something that is changing its property over a long time, then you would prefer other type of material which have less change in the property over the time compared to neoprene, which have more change. Okay, so that's why for seismic isolation, we are going with the natural rubber now. Okay. Now, in terms of construction, okay, Rimpi, as I told you before, can you see you have foundation pedestals here? So below this, you might have a raft foundation or something else. On the top of that, you have basically this foundation pedestal, which are typically very rigid. And this isolator is connected through these external bearing plates and bolted to this pedestal here. Right. And on the top, you again have the same bearing plate. And then you can connect to the concrete columns or a steel column as the case may be. Okay. And you would have several of such bearings in plan. Okay. Yeah.
So one question. So please go to the previous. So basically, sir, we use lead in lead rubber bearing. So what is the basic like property that that's why we use the lead in bearing?
Lead is a malleable material. Do you know what's a malleable material is?
Yes, sir.
Malleable, that you can deform very easily. So yeah, it does not provide any stiffness. However, it's a perfectly plastic material. Okay, there is very less elasticity, I mean almost negligible elasticity associated with lead. So what happens? It dissipates a lot of energy. At the same time, if you, because it's malleable, okay, if you consider a steel rod and if you deform it below, like, you know, beyond the elastic limit, it would have some permanent deformation, right? And even if you bring it back, this steel, to its original position, it won't recover its original property, isn't it? It would have some permanent deformation. However, lead, because it is malleable, rubber is elastic. You might have permanent deformation because of lead, but rubber, when you displace it, it tries to bring it back to its original position and basically restores the position of the lead. Now, what happens with the lead? It provides energy dissipation, but when you bring it back to its original position, after some time, at molecular level, or like, you know, it recrystallizes, all the property or the mechanical properties of lead is actually recovered. So you still have the same bearing that you started with, okay, without any change in the property or significant change in the property. Mm-hmm. So that's why lead is used, not steel or any other material.
Okay. So, but like aluminium is also malleable, but it is not fully plastic. That's why it is.
Aluminium, if you try to deform, it is malleable, but it won't recrystallize. Okay. So it is, the recrystallization properties of lead is much better compared to aluminium. Okay. So that's why lead is used.
Mm-hmm. So I have one question.
Yes.
This photograph which is shown here, Turkey, that hospital building, actual placed the bearing. So actually, because of its huge size and huge weight, it stays in position. Otherwise, there is, we cannot connect steel plate to the rubber elastomer. It stays in position, not getting displaced because of its size and heavy weight coming.
No, it is not. Actually, in this case, it is not because of heavy weight. Let me just show you typical construction so that. So this is the magnified view. Can you see it?
Yes, yes.
So what is basically here? See, these are the holes you can see, which are still to be bolted, right?
Yes, but there is no connection between the.
Can you see these holes? Can you see these holes? These are bolted to this internal steel plate.
Okay.
So as you can see, these holes are connected to the columns and the foundations below. But these holes, and you can see that these are actually not unfilled. You can see there are tack. Basically, these are bolted here. So this is the external bearing plate. These holes go all the way inside these bolts. Mm-hmm. And these are connected to the internal bearing plates. And basically, what you see here, after that, once you have this bolt connected to this internal bearing plate, it is fused. This one is fused or bonded with this rubber layer. And for the subsequently what you see here. So here it is not because of weight. There are bearings, which are called unbonded.
Hmm.
Unbonded bearings, which just stays there because of their own weight and friction.
Hmm.
But what you see here that I have shown you, these are bonded rubber bearings, not unbonded rubber bearings.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So can you all of you see that this is how we typically construct? Because this is one of the confusion that comes whenever you think about it. Well, if something is flexible, how can you take the whole weight of the building while still being so flexible? Remember, it is flexible in the horizontal direction. And because of multiple layering, it still has enough or adequate vertical capacity to take the vertical loads. Okay. And foundation, you typically make it very rigid. Okay, so that there is no deformation in foundation. So this is a typical rubber bearing manufacturing process. Basically, you start with mixing of rubber. You take raw rubber, carbon black, sulfur, and other additives are mixed as required. Okay, and then you manufacture sheets. From these sheets, basically you cut rubber in the desired shape. Actually, in the next class, I'll show you some figures that will make it more clear. Okay. Then you cut the rubber, and then the steel plate surface and all these adhesive are applied. Actually, it is better that I show you in the next class with all the figures and everything, so it would be more clear. Okay. So let me just skip that. So let us first show you what is the low damping rubber bearing. Now, what I've seen you, the internal construction of a low damping rubber bearing. Okay. There is no lead core here. Okay. And on the left hand side, what is there is basically this rubber bearing is actually cut in half. So what you are seeing here, the internal construction, multiple rubber bears. Remember, in the end, what you see here is basically rubber cover. Cover is provided to rubber bearing as well to protect the debonding at the interfaces because it is very vulnerable at those points. Okay. And sometimes you might see a central hole. The whole idea behind providing a central hole is from the manufacturing perspective, it allows proper distribution of heat during the vulcanization or curing process. Okay. Because if you have internal, hole, basically it allows uniform distribution of heat so that it cures properly and you get good bonding between rubber and steel shims. Okay, so this is a low damping rubber bearing. Similar construction, you would have lead rubber bearing, but you would now, instead of a central hole or without hole, you will have a lead core now. Okay, and there are methods through which you can decide that what is or how to find out the diameter of the lead core. Okay. In terms of sliding bearings, you can have a flat sliding bearing. You can have single friction bearing for with a single sliding surface. You can have double friction bearing, double FP bearings, which double sliding surface, as you can see here. Okay. Or you can have triple, in which you have one sliding surface here, one sliding surface here, and then one sliding surface here. Okay. So this is a magnified view of a single friction bearings. Okay. You have a sliding surface. Then this is a double friction pendulum bearings. Now, a question you might ask, why do I need to go if I have this single friction pendulum bearing? Why should I go for double friction or triple friction pendulum bearing anyway? Now, what happens if you go for double friction or triple friction pendulum bearing? These would provide you enough or larger displacement capacity with similar or smaller footprint, because you have multiple sliding surface now. Okay. In this case, this would just slide to the end. Okay. And that's the end of it. But on this one, first, this would slide to the end. Then this can again slide over the top of this one. So the displacement capacity is actually increased. Okay. If you increase the number of sliding surface further, again your displacement capacity is further increased. Okay. So if the structure where you want to apply seismic isolation have very small footprint, let us say very small columns, and you cannot fit larger bearings, then you can go for triple friction pendulum bearing, because it would have smaller footprint or smaller dimension, and it would provide you similar or higher capacity than single friction pendulum bearing or elastomeric bearing. Okay. Any doubt up to this point? Anybody? Okay. So before I get into all technical things and everything, you know, from the next class, let us see some famous applications around the world and in India of seismic isolation technology to give you some, you know, idea that where all it could be applied. Although this is limited set of applications that I'm going to show you, it would give you an idea that it can be applied for, like, you know, diverse range of structures. Okay. One of the application you can see here, and this is a lead rubber bearing. This was a historic building in California. Okay. Now, the problem with this building was, it's a historic building. And what's the world? And, like, you know, this is in California, so this is in, like, in a very high seismic zone. Okay. Now, what is the one thing that you need to care most about retrofitting a historic building? So this building was in a high seismic zone. Okay. And this need to be protected, but because it is already existing, it is already there, you cannot redesign it. Of course, it's a historic building, so you cannot change the features of the building or architectural aspect of it. Okay. So what do you do then? Well, you can retain the same building. At the same time, you can use seismic isolation. So in this case, what they did, they went below the foundation of this building, cut each of the columns and put lead rubber bearings one by one, okay, below the foundation. Okay. So with minimal architectural, in fact, from the outside, nobody even knows, if you, like, you know, if not a structural engineer or not, do not know about this building, you would not even know that it has been seismically isolated from the outside. Similarly, US Court of Appeals, in this one, lead rubber bearing was used. Similarly, in this case, sliding bearing used. Now, many times what happens, as I told you, okay, we want isolation, but to control the deformation, we also want damping. Many times you can provide it with the isolator itself, like high damping rubber bearing or lead rubber bearing. Many times that damping might not be sufficient. Now, what you see here is a San Bernardino Hospital in California. 400 high damping rubber bearings were used, okay, with very large displacement capacity. But to get additional damping, you can see isolator here. they had also used the linear non-linear viscous damper here, because the damping achieved by the isolator was not sufficient. Okay, so here viscous damper was used in conjunction with the isolator to allow adequate isolation as well as damping capacity. Okay, now isolation can be used not only for building but also for bridges. What you see here is a Woodrow Wilson Bridge, which is basically like, you know, it connects Virginia and Maryland in the US. What is basically a bearing which are below each of these supports. Okay, and this is called bi-scule type bridge. Okay, and each of these support points you have lead rubber bearings. Okay, so these are used for the bridges as well. Then let us see an example of offshore platform. What you see here is actually an offshore platform in Russia, and there are four foundations here. Okay, and the whole weight of the superstructure needed to be supported on these four foundations. So what they have done here, they have used single friction pendulum bearings here to support the whole structure. Now these provide dual purpose, from the earthquake as well as from wave loading. Okay, now if you know about offshore structure, those are constantly subjected to low frequency waves. Okay, so this protects the superstructure from the ocean waves as well. So it basically satisfy the dual purpose. Now this is a very big LNG tank in Greece, and these have been isolated using multiple friction pendulum bearings, and you can see the basically the foundation plan. These are all the pedestal. On top of the pedestal you have these friction bearings. Okay, and actually seismic isolation technology has been implemented for nuclear structure as well. In fact, one of the very first application was to nuclear structure, and this is a nuclear power plant in France where the nuclear building was isolated, and I have shown you the design of isolator. This was neoprene pads, not natural rubber, and this has been used to isolate the nuclear building in France. There has been also a recent, so this was like, you know, long time ago, but there has been a recent application as well, and the India is also part of this project, International Thermonuclear Building. Remember, till now the nuclear power plant that you might have heard of, or this is based on fission. Now they are trying, and that, like, you know, fission has radiation problem and other issues. Now they are trying to develop the fusion technology, okay, using hydrogen and, like, you know, other things. So there are an international consortium project, and this is an international thermonuclear reactor in France again, and this has also been seismically isolated. In fact, if you would like to see more of the construction drawings and everything, I would strongly encourage you, you go to this website www.iter.org. They have put all the construction drawing, design plans of all the bearings, how they were constructed in stages, and it's like, you know, there are a lot of useful information. And let us look at some Indian application as well. Okay, so one of the first, the very first application of seismic isolation in India was the Bhuj Hospital, which was destroyed after the 2001 Gujarat earthquake. And then they constructed this bearing hospital, okay, using square rubber bearings, which were supplied by Robinson Seismic, which is a company that supplies, in fact, company that actually invented lead rubber bearing, from New Zealand. Okay, so they provided the rubber bearings. You can see here they have a basement building here. Okay, at the top of this they have these rubber bearings at the top of each basement. Okay, and then you have the superstructure. Okay, actually there has been a very recent application as well, and this is the Patna Police Headquarters, Sardar Patel Bhavan in Patna, and this has been also isolated using lead rubber bearings provided by the Dynamic Isolation Systems, which are a US-based company, okay, and very famous internationally for providing rubber bearings. Okay, so this has been a very recent application. And there are other projects also under consideration right now in design phases, not yet constructed. So in India, actually, seismic isolation technology is gaining a lot of ground because it leads to economic savings. Okay, so less cost overall, of course, much better safety. Okay, so if you have a critical structure, it would have much better safety. And then, like, you know, in terms of performance-based engineering as well, it would not only lead to the safety of the structure, but internal components as well. Okay, so that's where there are a lot of code activities that are happening nowadays. And recent code has been actually issued by Bureau of Indian Standard. You can go have a look at it. If you want, I can share the copy. Okay, that would now allow Indian design practitioner to actually use isolation for different type of structures in India. Okay, so with that, you should always keep in mind, as an engineer or as a researcher, should not talk about only good things. You should know about any technology, what are the limitations, so that you can effectively address those limitations. And that is the whole design perspective, right? The whole design philosophy is about that, that you know the problem and then you address that problem using some design measure. So isolation, as we have talked about, see, mostly we talked about horizontal shaking, right? But at many places, there might be vertical shaking as well, and it might be significant. But isolations that we have till now considered only addresses horizontal shaking, not the vertical shaking. Okay. So those are one of the challenges of seismic isolation, that it cannot effectively address vertical isolation. Although there have been, like, you know, researchers who have proposed vertical isolations and other kind of things, but remember, the applications of those are limited because those have not been shown so effective for large scale implementation of full scale structures. Okay. And then there is isolation interface. Remember, your structure is not standing, you know, by itself. There would be power lines going to the structure. There would be pipelines going to the structure. Okay. Now, and those would be going from your structure to the ground. Now your isolation only isolate the structure from the ground. But if you have those utilities passing from the structure to the ground, those should be designed to accommodate the isolated deformation. Okay. Then those are practical consideration. Also from the design and the testing, you might have, like, you know, testing and characterization issue and then accurate modeling issue. Okay. But it is, like, you know, with the recent development, it is hoped that seismic isolation would likely to be adopted for different type of a structure, especially in India, because of the saving it provides. Design in terms of, like, you know, efficacy of resistance against earthquake that it provides. Okay. And with the performance-based analysis, it would allow us a better comparison of fixed base versus base isolated building in terms of performance measure, like not only in terms of structure, but also in terms of acceleration and velocity, which would be important for internal equipments and components. Okay.